We have a connection through the cadres of the Socialist Party. You have it, of course, through the democratic discussion and so on. But where was the connection between what happened in 37, 38, for the modern working class in Russia, who were beginning to move against the bureaucracy? There was no accountability. If in the 1980s, we would have had an accountability in Russia of Stalinism in an honest fashion, a balance sheet of what took place, then undoubtedly the best elements of the working class would have moved to examine Trotsky, the left opposition. The best of them did, by the way. They went into the secret libraries in Moscow and St. Petersburg. We got that through the contacts that we had to study history. The big files that were taken out were the speeches of the left opposition. We have to remember, when this man says, well, the Trotskyists were nothing in Russia, there were 10,000 Trotskyists in the camps in 1936, 1937. Young boys of 14 and 15, Stalin introduced a law that any child over the age of 12 who was in the family of a left oppositionist was liable to execution, to be put on trial and to be executed. And they were executed with their families as well. Every single relative of Trotsky was killed. The same with Buchanan, who capitulated. The same with Zinoviev and so on. Why? To break the historical memory of the working class. To break the traditions of workers' democracy. Of the ideas of Lenin. Never mind of Trotsky. The heroic ideas of the revolution itself. And therefore, these marvellous men and women, I mentioned this in conclusion, by the way, were shot out of hand like dogs in the tundra, were shouting their resistance to Stalinism in the frozen tundra. Real heroes and heroines. Films will be made of them, by the way. Books will be written about them, these nameless heroes who went to their deaths shouting, long live the Russian Revolution, long live Lenin, long live Trotsky, and long live the Fourth International. And this man says, well, Trotskyism was nothing. It was wiped out. Unfortunately, because of through the crimes of Stalin, and but nevertheless, their memory has not been erased because it's restored by books like this by Rugavan and, of course, by ourselves in the material that we produce. By the way, before I just pass on, one of the major charges that Servis makes in this book is, well, Trotsky was in favour of terror. Trotsky never in any way apologised for the role that was played by the Young Workers' State. Well, who started the terror, by the way? It wasn't the working class. The working class in Russia took power relatively peacefully. Very few people were killed in the Winter Palace. They were enormously generous. Trotsky himself admitted in that film, he was talking about the Dewey Commission that was set up to examine the Moscow trial. It came out and found Trotsky and his son Leon instead of not guilty in the Moscow trials. By the way, Solzhenitsyn also wrote a big book, The Gulag Archipelago. He doesn't mention Trotsky and Lenin were the major defendants in their absence in the Moscow trials. How can you write 1,000 pages about the Gulag, have a subhead or a little note on the Trotskyists, who were the most heroic in the camp, who went on hunger strikes and won a victory to be treated as political prisoners, and then because of that, Stalin personally gave the order that every one of them should be shot in the camps. How can you say, argue in this particular way that Servis does, it can only be interpreted as a monstrous new falsification of history? But one of the arguments is, well, Trotsky was in favour of terrorism. The workers in Russia, as Trotsky himself said in that Dewey Commission, he said we were incredibly generous. We released General Krasnov on his say-so that he wouldn't engage in civil war. He went away and immediately organised an army of counter-revolution, and thousands of workers were slaughtered as a result of that mistake, by the way, that was made by the Bolsheviks. And I posed the question in my material, in my short review, and we'll go into it in any greater detail. He accuses Lenin and Trotsky of not wanting to have other parties existing in Russia between 1917 and 1922-23. On the contrary, the Mensheviks were allowed to operate, the social revolutionaries were allowed to operate, all those parties that accepted the idea of working within the framework of the system accepted. And even the Mensheviks who didn't accept the Russian Revolution were actually accepted as legal parties. They were only legalized when they supported the whites, when they went over to the counter-revolution. The only party that was legalised in Russia after the revolution was the Black Hundreds, the equivalent of the BNP in Britain, only much bigger than the BNP in Russia. In other words, a right-wing, semi-fascistic organisation was outlawed at that stage. And I posed the question, and we get no reply to this. Did Abraham Lincoln, who was a great Democrat, who was presiding over the American Civil War, did they allow the South to operate openly in the North during the Civil War, produce newspapers, argue and mobilise a force to overthrow the government? Not at all. It was partly ruled by the sword. They allowed Oliver Cromwell, when he took power in Britain, did he allow the king and the forces in Oxford to operate freely within the territory of the parliamentarians at all? And therefore, this argument of terrorism is entirely false. And we would say, by the way, this is an attempt to try and picture the Trotskyists today as favouring the methods of the Bolsheviks in the 1917 revolution and its aftermath. History's moved on. The greatest task for Marxists and Trotskyists today is to conquer the political support of the working class. So dominant of the working class in the modern era, it will not be a repeat of the Russian Revolution. This was in a backward country. That's why I mentioned Germany. When Lenin and Trotsky said it was easier to take power, wasn't easy, but it was easier to take power in Russia than it would be in an advanced industrial country. But it was more difficult to hold the power in Russia, he said, unless the revolution spread internationally because of the objective situation, the cultural backwardness, paucity of resources and so on. That's why the main task for Marxism is today is to conquer the working class, not by force of arms, of course, but by ideas, to win over the majority of the working class. You win the majority of the working class, as was the case in Germany in 1923, the question of the socialist revolution would be much easier. Would we illegalise other parties? We say openly, no, the Tories will have every right to exist. The only difference will be that the militants, as it was, the socialists today, will be the same size and the same circulation as the Daily Express. And the Daily Express will be the size of the socialists today, probably with less actual effect on the population. We wouldn't mind Rupert Murdoch going on the street corners around here or central London and say, go back to capitalism, mass unemployment, poverty and the rest that goes with it. It would have the same effect, by the way, today. There is somebody who was arguing, let's go back to Merry England, let's go back to feudalism. But Oliver Cromwell had to take the sword to suppress feudalism and cleared the way for the development of capitalism. We wouldn't do that today because they just looked as an oddity. Anybody going, I mean, we all enjoy modest dancing and the bells and what have you. But nevertheless, it would be looked as rather quaint. Somebody wanting to go back to that kind of society. In other words, if a workers' state was established, a democratic workers' state was established, the action would have such little basis. Of course, they would have the right to put forward their ideas, and we would defeat them in argument. In the same way as we would defeat Service, who's not confident of his position and is not prepared to argue for his situation itself. Comrades, I think that if you look at the whole arguments of Lenin and Trotsky, and particularly Trotsky's role, I've only touched on a few of the points to open up the discussion here today. You'll see it's a marvellous treasure trove. I repeat, it's not a question of Trotsky being a hero, although I say, quite frankly and openly, he's more of a hero to me than any premiership star or football club, and I'm very interested in football, as comrades might know, or any pop group and so on. This is a real hero who achieved things as far as the working class is concerned.